Hi, everybody. Welcome to Habitat Now. I'm your host, Aaron Shea, and it's an honor to have you join me for February's Not Grandma's Glass NGG presenter, Mike DuPont. Now, as many of you know, because I've repeated it a few times, I'm going to go ahead and mute everybody, so feel free to unmute yourself. This show is about artwork that's not currently in Grandma's art collection yet, but I've learned over the years, since this is our third year of the show, that a few of these artists are, and they are unbelievably talented, and I want to put a spotlight in a snakes on a plane approach name of a show. We've had some traction getting articles published in magazines. We've been on TV promoting it, and we're going to continue our efforts here. And we do these NGG presentations usually around the first of every month because there's 12 artists invited. The whole list is on notgrandmasglass.com. And today is Mike DuPont's turn, so we're honored to have you. I'm going to go ahead and start sharing my screen and we can go through this little event today. So thanks again for joining me. So I've been telling this the last couple Zooms because people have been messaging me about joining these. On our website, under the virtual presentation tab, there's a button there for every week in case you miss an email or you didn't receive the notification. The link is there for the RSVP under the virtual presentation tab. And you can also see the past virtual presentations there up to like February of last year, and the rest of them on YouTube. This month, many of you are joining us in Florida for our 8th annual Glass Coast Weekend. It is going to be an amazing event. We're having a great turnout of both clients and artists, and you're invited to come see it. It's going to be 4 exhibitions on display, including a solo by artist Wilfred Grootens, a legendary exhibition, and a pioneer exhibition. And then the show I curated called Gravity Bound Art. I just got confirmation that we're able to use the Ringling College of Art and Design's glassblowing state-of-the-art facility for a demonstration by Davide Salvadori. So that happened as of 2 days ago. We finally got that clear. So Davide's going to be down, and it's going to be quite amazing. And something else is, for early birds, we're going to go see the Thurman Statham show, which is on-site in one of the galleries of the Ringling College of Art and Design. And then on top of the auction we're doing and visiting the Ringling Museum and the Imagine Museum, which is things I've talked about at the last talk, on Friday after the auction, the entire Ringling campus has a huge art display experience where there'll be demonstrations and music and food trucks. And it's like from 5 to 8 o'clock. So we're going to open up the gallery for the locals, but it's going to be a heck of a weekend. So I hope you plan on coming down. These are the artists coming in. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, plus 30, 40, the list goes on. It's an amazing time to see the people we know and are part of our Habitat family. So make sure you have a chance to come see us. These are the exhibitions. I won't really go into it because I just talked about it. And again, February 24th to 26th. The Masterworks auction is online now. There's maybe 20 days left before the auction, maybe even less. So check it out on our website, habitat.com. There's a link on the site to see our new auction platform, the Masterworks platform, which has a lower cost of buyer's premium. But if you want the lowest cost, contact me for the 16% premium for payment via check or bank wire or cash. So keep that in mind. Once you look at the auction, just give me a call and place bids. Upcoming in March, we have a solo show by Mark Laputa. We're hoping to have some of his work down at the Glass Coast Weekend. It's our first exhibition with Mark, and we're just ecstatic about his work because it's so beautiful and stunning. Talked about NGG, so we'll skip that. The glass tours are happening in July. We've talked about that a bit. If you love glass and you love cruise ships, it's the best thing to do. Contact me for details. And then obviously lastly, in June of this year, we've moved our international to overlap the GAS conference, which is going on at the same time as the Michigan Glass Project. So much going on this upcoming year. This should have been the year of glass, but more of the story is let's continue on. So without further ado, Mike, I want to welcome you and want you to say hello to everybody as I stop sharing my screen and I pull into yours.
Hello, everyone. Give me 1 second.
No problem. It's great to have you. So we had Mike join us in our Pop and Lock exhibition in 2019, and we had our first time exhibiting the work, and it was very powerful work, and it talked about the concept of addiction. So we'll be viewing quite a variety of his life and career, so I'm excited to see that. All right, Mike, you took over the screen, and all I got to do is go to the first one and click the button. You're in gear. Well, thanks for joining us, Mike, and again, say hi to everybody.
Yeah, hello, everyone. Thanks for taking time out of your day to listen to me talk about my life and my work. Thanks for Habitat, Aaron, for the invite to this. It's kind of a big deal for me. I don't do this kind of thing often, so it's kind of a nice change of pace, and I hope you find what I have to say interesting. So this is a little bit about me, just kind of thinking about how to sum up like what I do, who I am. I was adopted at birth, and I'll go into more of that kind of as we get going. But I grew up in Illinois, been here my whole life. Grew up in the northwest suburbs of Chicago, received my degree in glass sculpture at Illinois State University. I graduated in 2012, and pretty much immediately after that, I started working at Nutrier High School, which is in the North Shore of Chicago. It's probably one of the bigger schools in the state. We have about 4,500 kids, and I'll talk more about that in a bit. But yeah, I have a master's degree in secondary education. Education was not something that I thought I would find myself involved with, you know, after college. So I kind of fell backwards into that through my journey in glass, which is kind of cool. I currently reside in Grays Lake, Illinois, which is about 45 minutes north of the city. And I'm currently building like a small shop in my garage so I can be kind of closer to home, because I do have two kids. So that's been a huge part of this move. We just moved in the summer, so it's kind of still, everything's new, you know, kind of still settling into to where we're at. But so yeah, just starting with Illinois State University, this was kind of a unique experience for me, because originally I had thought that I was going to be a graphic design major. I started design work in high school, you know, taking all the classes and then going through the motions. And I was actually getting little gigs around the school, designing things like, you know, the directory, the phone book for our high school, for t-shirt designs, for sports, kind of just like random odd jobs. So I for a long time, I thought that design was going to be kind of my focus as a career, a creative career. And I found a lot of interest in illustrating. So these are two illustrations that I found. I don't have much design work anymore from college. I threw that computer away a long time ago and didn't save anything, but these are the two that I actually did save. So this is just like something I drew freehand on the computer. And at the time, I think when I was trying to think, my first year at Illinois State, I actually had an internship lined up. I knew a guy that worked in the Blackhawks office. So I made this for my portfolio, and I was going to do an internship with them that summer. But second semester, I discovered glass, and that pretty much changed my path.
You do have a heck of a grasp of a line, man. Those are impressive drawings.
Thank you. Yeah. So these are freehand too. Like I don't use, like, I never like sketched anything. So it's just kind of like, I found a lot of, I think it was interesting for me. Like it was something new. Like I had been drawing since I was a kid, but drawing it on the computer just felt like a new modern way to approach illustrating. And, you know, so yeah, I don't do much of this stuff anymore. But it was fun, you know, for me to get involved in that. But yeah, then I discovered glass, and that kind of derailed that whole career. So Illinois State was unique. Our shop wasn't anything fancy by any means. So, you know, in order to make anything, you had to constantly be fixing stuff. So that's when I kind of learned a lot of like the equipment and like the technical aspects of how like the studio functions. At the time we had two grad students, Slate Grove and John Moran, and John Miller is the head professor. So this show that I'm a part of right now, Not Grandma's Glass, it's a real big honor for me to be a part of something like this, because Slate was my Glass One professor, and he is, I think he's June. Is that right, Aaron?
I think so. Yeah. He's later on in the year.
Yeah. You know, and John Moran last year was one of the winners of this, and of Blown Away. So it's cool that kind of come full circle. You know, these guys taught me pretty much everything I knew about glass in the hot shop, technical aspects, but then also just working alongside them and picking their brains about materials, about their decision making when it comes to making sculptures. You know, those are all things that kind of shape the way I create now, and the things that I am bringing into my own work. They are the reason that all of that is happening. So,
and they're good guys too.
Yeah, and they're great guys. Yeah. Right. So, no, yeah, and John Miller did teach me some technical stuff, but I think I learned more about, like, you know, the professional side of glass. You know, going to shows, how to set things up, how to tear shows down, talking to whoever, communicating, networking. I learned more of that with John, even though he does seem kind of chaotic at times. He did teach me a lot of that side of things. So, you know, the three of them obviously were a huge impact in what I'm doing today. So, many thanks to them. These two, Jason Chakravarty and Jennifer Caldwell, are also two people that kind of kept me interested in different processes of glass. So I don't really consider myself to be a glass blower. I like to just say a mixed media artist that chooses to use glass, because I use pretty much any kind of glass that we have at where I work, which is flame working, casting, the hot shop, kiln forming glass, you know, slumping, fusing. Everything interests me. And I think the nature of my job forces me to kind of work in as many different areas of glass as I can, because we have 200 plus kids on a daily basis come through the studio, and they have ideas about making whatever they got to make, and I got to be kind of ready to do whatever. So that part of my life kind of keeps me heavily engaged in learning new techniques and steps to whatever process, you know. And Jason being a caster, Jennifer being a flame worker, I think they really pushed me to explore new areas of glass that I wasn't really comfortable with, you know. After I kind of had a good skill set foundation in the hot shop. So big thanks to them. I mean, that's, you know, without their help, I probably wouldn't be doing all this stuff on my own. So this is just a shot of Illinois State's hot shop. It's pretty rugged. A lot of that equipment's pretty old and has been rebuilt many times, but it was home for, you know, my learning experience, and it was a great place to learn, and it really changed my life dramatically. So moving on, after I graduated from Illinois State, I literally graduated on Saturday and I started working at New Trier on that Monday. So the transition wasn't anything too lengthy. It was pretty immediate. And this kind of happened in a way that was, I didn't expect to work in a high school, but at the time I had been working in a production studio and part-time with Jason as my boss. And, you know, he had been building all this equipment, and I wasn't really sure like what the equipment was for. And then finally, as it got closer to my graduation, Jason was like, you know, this is all this equipment's going to a school. They had a grant that they approved, and they need someone on board to run the facility and maintain the equipment. So that's when I kind of talked to the teacher that started the program, who is Monique Boyd. She started the program in 2005. And since then, it's taken off, and it's currently the most popular elective at New Trier. We have 8 out of the 8 classes running with glass clubs after school, and glass art 1, 2, and 3, and summer school, and it's just wild. So
that is amazing.
Yeah, it's a pretty amazing facility. This is our 4th floor, looking down into the the main concourse, I guess is what you would call it. So it is in a more affluent community in Chicago. We are blessed for our budget, you know, having the money and the facilities to have a shop like this. So you can see here, we got 2 ovens. We have 24 torches, cold working, fusing, slumping. Yeah, this is the class.
This is all in high school, right?
This is a high school. Yeah.
That's absolutely incredible.
So the campus I'm at, there's actually 2 campuses. So there's so many kids that they isolated freshmen to a different campus. So the freshmen go to Northfield, which is just, it's about 10 minutes from where I'm at. But then upperclassmen are at this campus. This is the Winnetka campus. So this is right on the lake. So this facility is pretty new. It's only about 5 years old. They tore down 60% of the school, rebuilt it. And then, we actually had a say in what went into building our studio, which is incredible. So Monique had a lot of good conversations with architects. The space, we wanted like an open kind of atmosphere to monitor kids, you know, working in all different areas. It's a really nice space to be working in all day, every day. But the only concern is ventilation. It's not great, but this is our hot shop. We actually just got a grant approved for a second wet dog hole. So that'll be next year. I think they're hoping it'll be ready. Supply chain issues obviously have thrown in a wrench to all that. But yeah, this furnace is new with the building. And it's incredible having kids working in the shop all day. You know, I have both holes on usually, and it's just constant. Kids come in the free periods. They're, staying late, coming early. I mean, it's just, we always have people working in the shop doing creative stuff. So it's great. So my early work, I think looking back on it, I never really had a good amount of content, I think, in the early stuff. And a lot of it is just because I feel like in college, you don't have time to practice techniques, you're making stuff. Yeah. And you get that practice, but you're making stuff to get it done for the deadline. So I honestly didn't really have a whole lot of time to practice the material until I had my job. And that was just kind of a weird thing to think about. At least for me, that's how it was. Maybe for others it's different, but a lot of my early stuff was material exploration, pushing technique, and really trying to understand what glass is. Everything seemed to go by so quickly in college that I really didn't get a good amount of time to sit back and digest kind of what I had been learning. So this job allowed me to, get better at teaching it, but also get better at really understanding what I'm doing and what the material is doing, based on what I'm making. So I started early on. I was really invested in figurative sculpting. I took Martin's class, took Raven's class. I watched Sleepy and Slate sculpt many different things in the hot shop. So figurative sculpting was something that really gained my attention early on. And this one on the left here is pretty early on in the process. Just trying to figure out, face structure and clothing, and trying to understand how to inside sculpt. The more I got into sculpting, the more I steered away from inside sculpting and started doing solid sculpture. I found it easier to use Sleepy's method of outside sculpting, where you're pulling out of the bubble instead of pushing from the inside. So a lot of these are a combination of inside and outside. This is, like I said before, I really found one right way to do things for myself. But this is early on, and then it kind of, figuring out hands and limbs. Also assembling things, and then this one was pushing scale, making things bigger with maintaining the same amount of detail. I think that one was pretty successful for the time. And then this one was kind of how far can I push the detail on shirts and, making it look like fabric. So yeah, these were kind of early examples of my figurative stuff. Mold making techniques. I tried my best to do a lot of different classes, for casting and stuff. So this is one class I took out in Goggleworks with Jason, learning different mold making techniques and different things that you can take molds off of. So this is my teeth, actually. Just playing around again with glass. This is encased in resin. And this looks like stone, but this is a good example of my mixed media skills, painting. It's actually insulation pink insulation foam that I painted to make it look like stone. So it does have like a heavy appearance, but it gives it the illusion that it's really heavy in weight, but it really isn't. So stuff like that. This is not glass, but I'm utilizing characteristics of glass. So this does have like a reflective surface. It's kind of hard to tell from this photo, but it's actually a frame and it has like depth to it. These are metal spikes coming out of the top. I designed all this in the computer. This was a good first attempt at blending kind of my design work with sculpture. I'd never done something like that. So this was a self-portrait I did in college. The whole thing sealed with resin. And I've, you know, watching Sleepy work, he does a lot of resin application to bind glass to fabric and metal. So he uses it as an adhesive. So, but it also has shiny qualities. It's shiny and seductive, just like glass can be, you know. So trying to utilize these materials maybe as a way to avoid using glass if I don't have to do it, you know. One of the big things for me that I've been thinking about is my success to fail ratio. There's things that I'm just not good at doing. So if I can get around doing it with a different material, but it gives me the same results as glass, I'm probably going to go that route. But this was a good experimental piece. I had a lot of fun making this too, just on the computer, just diving back into drawing, illustrating. And then using metal. I do have a lot of skill in metalworking. So this skull was actually cast in pewter. Pewter is a really soft metal. It can melt at a very low melting point, but it's really dense and heavy. So I actually made this into like a lamp. So you turn a little knob and it turns the lamp on and off. So yeah, just more material exploration and trying to figure out, you know, what it all means, where it's all going. So, and then after that, I kind of moved into these clown figures. Now, I really wanted to push emotion with these like facial structures and how your face moves with different expressions, sad, happy, really trying to get those techniques down. Glass has a memory. So whenever you make a mark in the glass, you know, it's going to remember what tool made that mark. So part of this series was kind of trying to make all these marks with intentional thought going into it, but also trying to hide them and make cleaner decisions, you know, when it came down to it. So I overemphasized emotions, but I tried my best to kind of start to play around with expression using hot glass. So these are all, I think most of them are solid sculpted on blown forms. I think there are a few that are blown. I like the contrast in black and white. I feel like the white around the eyes and the mouth helped it pop, you know, helped the emotion kind of stand out against the black. But these pieces were really fun to make. And I learned a lot, you know, trying to really push, push expression and emotion. This one, I actually tried to do John Rand's technique of layering bits to make eyelids. So, you know, he does the whole eyeball structure where I was just using rods and just kind of filling it in. But again, you know, just trying to understand technique and adding teeth. You know, teeth is something that is a little challenging because you have to open the form and then add the teeth without melting things too much, and then close the mouth down to make it a little more believable. So some of these are pretty wild, pretty out there, but I learned a lot from all of this. And you can kind of see the fingers are really clunky, and even the detail part of, you know, how to set up your initial shape to make cleaner hands. The fingers are really bulky. I can look at this and kind of shake my head now because it's just totally different, you know, from the stuff that I can make now. But it's fun, you know, to document the stuff and look back on the way that I was thinking at that time and how it has evolved, you know, with time. So consumer education was the first time that I really wanted to start thinking about more serious subject matter and actually put content to my work. So this all started thinking about the way I experienced education as a kid. Basically, the public school system that I was part of pushed my mom into a corner and forced my parents to medicate me as a kid. That was the only option they provided my parents. So that's kind of where this body of work started. But I do pull from other aspects of life, dealing with drug addiction, substance abuse. But it was the kind of the first attempt of like, you know, I have this idea and I have a good understanding of how I want to start this, but how, you know, how far can I go and stretch this idea before it becomes too mentally draining? And that's what happened with this body of work. It got to a point where I was just in this negative headspace for so long that I just had to stop making stuff for it. It brings up a lot of bad memories of, you know, my experience in school and a teenager and, you know, all this stuff. But I think these pieces are really successful. And it's interesting. I've talked to a lot of different people about them, and it's amazing how many people have connected to the work based on their own life experiences or people that they know. So please do not feed the animals. This is a good example of like kind of blending what I had been doing at Nutrier with some of my hot sculpting interests. So this thing is actually sitting on a prescription pad of I made on the computer, and then I transferred that image onto sheet glass and I slumped it into this like nest kind of bowl shape. So the snake actually sits on that in the back. And then these are all pill capsules that I ordered. Everything's resined into place, so it kind of is held together that way. But you know, this is one of the first ones I did. All of these pieces are kind of exploring the idea of like, you know, why I hated taking medicine for being able to focus. And I think it just sucked the life out of me. I wasn't the same person I am today. It just was a really difficult part of my life. There was one part of my life too where they accidentally wrote down the wrong number of medication. So I was just taking way more than what I should have been, and I started hallucinating. So some of these things are kind of relating to that, the monsters that are kind of, you know, that I was seeing at night before I would fall asleep. The way I set these all up, I showed these at SOFA in 2018, and the way I set them up was kind of like it looked like a laboratory. So like everything was kind of either trying to break out of their cages or being dissected. So it was kind of like a step into the way that I felt like I was being observed as a student, as a patient by doctors, trying to pick apart, you know, who and why I was doing what I was doing. It was really traumatic for me, you know, for many years. But again, these are pretty crazy pieces. So this is a scorpion that I made. All of them have this head that I feel like can kind of, my idea was that the head can kind of morph into anything, any kind of monster it can be. So it's not one thing, but it can be anything, you know? So I made this one in the Pittsburgh Glass Center, actually, during a class, Danny White's class, with the help of Danny and some other people. This was a pretty big piece, but altogether, I think it was 13 pieces, maybe. So this took a long time to make. But again, it was, you know, it was a challenge. And I think that going through like this process taught me so much more about the material, you know, and as well as how to talk to a team of people, you know, when you're putting something like this together. All of that transitions into what I'm doing now, and, you know, teaching kids how to kind of do the same thing, and communication is key when you're making anything in the hot shop. So
you showed a couple of these works at the Pop and Lock show too, right?
I did, yes. So this one, I think the snake one, and then this one, Deadweight. So this has the same thing engraved over and over again, take one tablet by mouth daily. So it's, this one is kind of symbolic of the repetition of taking medicine over and over and over again. You know, I printed out the same prescription pad papers and stuffed them in the mouth and used resin to make it look like it's like, you know, like holding it, but like also drooling. So it has this like effect of like, it's like got like saliva coming out of it. Another really symbolic piece, I think, that was successful with just kind of the way that I felt, you know, being forced to medicate as a kid. Bottom feeder is another one, just kind of lost in the pills as time, you know, as I grew older, as time went on. Interesting fact about this piece, I actually sold this piece to a family that they told me that their family has the patent to the lockable pill lid. So that was kind of interesting. They talked to me a lot about their own experiences with their kid. There was a lot of similarities with things that I went through. So this was something that they connected with pretty immediately when they saw it. And that's just one example, you know, of people that have connected to this work. I think some of it's pretty dark. Some of it is kind of out there, but that's the beautiful thing, I think, about like some work like this. You know, it's going to hit people differently. It's a small group of people probably that it'll touch, but you know, that's kind of like my hope with this stuff, is that it raises enough awareness, or you know, people can relate to it on some level. Again, this is stuff that I designed on the computer, printed them out, and then yeah, the label was all done on Adobe Illustrator. So again, this was one of the ones that I set up to make it look like it was being dissected. These were all the kind of things that were observed of me in the classroom as I was getting, you know, older and going through the motions of, you know, my elementary and secondary education. So these tags are kind of things that teachers would say to my parents and, you know, conferences or whatever. But I had this one actually set up with like dissection tools on a table with like a magnifying glass that was kind of like, you walk up to it and it looked like you were ready to dissect it further, you know. So yeah, these pieces, I tried teeth were something that I had never done this way, you know, laying the gums on and really trying to get the detail. I was fascinated by last month, Kimberly Thomas's teeth. You know, she had so many good details going that I feel like I only kind of scratched the surface of these. But looking back on it, if I were to go back, I would definitely try to make the teeth look a little bit more realistic, you know, than just layering the color and cutting it. But
yeah, she's pretty good.
Yeah. It's great. Inspiring, right?
Yeah.
So COVID was an interesting time for everyone. I think for me, it was, there was a big silver lining to COVID, just the amount of time that I had at home. And then I was also getting my master's at that time. So I had to develop curriculum during COVID, which was kind of crazy, you know, like, cause you go into teaching thinking like, you know, you go into student teaching thinking that you're going to have like a whole classroom of kids, you know, you're going to be able to interact with them, create these like intimate conversations about, you know, what they're making and how they're thinking. And that was just not the case at all. I had remote learners. I had some kids that were choosing to come in person. So it was really broken down into different areas of, you know, art making, which is kind of like interesting to live through that. But one of the things that was cool was like, I got to watch veteran teachers kind of revamp the way that they were teaching for 20 plus years, you know? So I was kind of on the front lines, giving, you know, listening, also giving input if it was needed. But things that I was thinking about was my furnace was off, administration wouldn't let us keep it on. So, because we were unsure when we were going to return. So the furnace was off. It forced me to rethink the way that I had been working, you know, because all that sculptural stuff that I've been just shown was predominantly what I had been doing. So it was reinventing myself through this weird time. I had to keep engaging kids somehow with, you know, new projects, things that were accessible for them at home, you know, without having the functionality of a full studio. And I also got more into torching. So like the building wasn't sick. So I was able to like go into work and do things. And this period of time is when I really started to focus on like a new body work and a new things that I wanted to explore with glass and graphic design. So I really wanted to get back into design and figure out ways of combining an old love with a newfound skill. So one of the things that I started to think about was propaganda. You know, I was watching the news for so long, you know, throughout the day that I was like, man, this is just, it's like war propaganda. I just kept thinking of war propaganda. So the first assignment I actually created was something that I was doing in my own artwork, which was kind of cool. I just started creating posters about COVID with, you know, the idea, the inspiration of World War II, World War I propaganda. So the first couple I have here are directly kind of related to that body of work, consumer education that I had just come off of. So the first two are kind of like just reflections on that, you know, using the character, using the themes of addiction and whatever, drug abuse, not really drug abuse, but drug usage. So I use this character, you know, like I said, he could be anything. So I turned him into COVID and just try to make a virus have a face, you know? So this thing, I painted the virus on the frame, how I mounted a N95 mask to it. So this piece was just something I did just to stay busy and stay creative during a weird time, you know, with the resources that I had. So that was kind of like the first one. This is another one, getting into the same kind of vein of what's it called, like the, you know, with consumer education, that series again, but just kind of changing the wording on these posters to make it mean something new. So that kind of opened, by exploring this on my own time, opened new doors for me to teach and engage kids, you know. So these are just other ones that I did. The Art of Selling War. This is a plug and a hand holding a heart. These are all 11 by 17. I actually sold this one to someone during the pandemic. So these were just done on the torch. They're just little clear pendants. I, you know, made them to make it look like bubbles. So during all of this, I had also been playing around with, so when I quit design, the last unit that I was kind of exploring was typography. And typography is interesting because any kind of, we call them typefaces or a font, you know, like people know them as fonts. Any typeface that you see was created by someone. So to me, that is a direct representation of the identity of the person that created it. So whether it's the inspiration that, you know, they had or who they are, you know, however they decided to make a typeface is a direct reflection of who that person is and why they decided to do it. So that's when I started really playing around with letters and kind of going back into the unit that I left off on and seeing what I could do with different materials, not just glass. So I started doing words. So this one says fixed, this is set, and this is prone. So prone is obviously exposed. I broke the frame in half intentionally to expose the glass on top. These were, again, experimental pieces, just seeing what it would be like to blend concrete with glass, using typography as my foundation to make these. So, you know, I think I didn't actually do anything with these. I kind of just, I haven't actually finished them. This is the only one I fixed, was the only one I finished. But prone and set are kind of still, I just haven't had time, but I am going to get back to these. I think this was a cool start to something, interesting. I don't know. But then that kind of led me to this series. So communication again is, it's utilizing typography, multiple typefaces, not just one. I'm exploring anatomy of type. So on a piece of paper or a computer screen, like print, your type is so small that like you don't actually see the negative spaces and the shapes that these things look like. So I've been blowing them up. I've been playing around with scale, playing around with the shapes of them, removing parts of them, blending them, creating objects out of them. Again, this is, it's all exploration at this point, but I've made a lot of good pieces, I think, that are kind of encapsulating all of these things. It's all around us. Type is all around us. You can break down anything that with words, you know, it exists all around us. So language is something that is, it's just, it's fascinating to me that we, you know, we have all these different typefaces we can use to express different emotions. And it's a form of identity that I think I've really attached to because of my own identity. So earlier on, I said I was adopted at birth. For 30 plus years, I have thought one way about myself. And then when I turned 30, I actually met my biological family. So that opened a whole new wave of questions and answers that I actually was able to get, you know, after wondering who I am for so long. So I still have 30 years worth of like knowledge and questions that I want to answer now, but I can't, I'm not ready to move forward with the answers I have because I need to still think about that part of my life that I'm not done creating yet. I don't know if that makes sense, but you know, so I met my biological brother and sister and mother through Facebook, which is kind of like a crazy thing. Facebook finally doing the one thing it was actually designed to do is find people and communicate with them. I don't have Facebook now, but at the time I told myself when I turned 30, I would try my best to find my family. So I did a basic Google search once I got my last name figured out. My parents gave me documents that had that, and I searched and I searched and I searched, and the one guy that popped up the picture looked like me. So it was kind of crazy. I reached out, long story short. We met, and that has just kind of flipped my world upside down because now I have answers to things that I didn't, but I still want to create the work that I was originally going to create. So these pieces are kind of exploring that part of my life, as well as new ideas and things that I'm thinking about that I'll kind of get into. So these first two are kind of where I started. Again, this was at home during COVID. I had these things mapped out and just kind of, you know, everything was really boxy at this point. And I was really, apathy was just kind of a word that came to mind, you know, sitting at home and trying to remain engaged and focused and energized during COVID, which is, it was hard. It was very hard to do. If you actually tilt your head and turn to the side, you can kind of see it's a lowercase a, if you kind of imagine it could use outside of the frame. And that was something, the frame, as I started making this piece, the frame became more and more difficult to work with. Mainly because I started realizing that I didn't want to have limitations with these, right? So everything's really boxy. It's really encased. And these are smaller pieces. I made this one after George Floyd was killed. He says, "Are you colorblind?" So this is actually a capital Q, and then I sculpted this out of clay, cast the whole thing. So again, limitations with this. I don't like the boxiness of this, and that was kind of, I made three of them. And the one I'm going to show you, once I broke away from the background, the craziness of the piece, and that's this one. So originally I had C is for carry. This one is really, I love this piece because I think it describes perfectly what I was saying about blowing letters up and to a size where it almost becomes unrecognizable. So when I blew up the C and I rotated it, this whole thing just reminded me of a womb. I started making this piece shortly after my second son was born. So the idea of removing it off of a background gave me more ways of thinking about why I made the piece to begin with. I love the fact that the baby is made out of ceramic. Ceramic is fragile, obviously, if it's dropped, but it's exposed on both sides. And I think this is really symbolic for something that every parent goes through. You know, there's parts of your life where you're very close to your kids, you protect them, but there's only so much you can do past a certain age. You know, you can't always be there for them. And these are all things that I think about as a parent. It freaks me out, you know, like any other parent thinks about their kids leaving. Not that mine are going to leave anytime soon. They're still very young, but it's all things that I fear. I'm just an anxious person. So that is something that I constantly think about. But this piece is kind of symbolic for that. But again, I had this originally on a background and it did not read the same way. But once I eliminated the background, this kind of opened up a lot of new ideas, thinking about these pieces kind of on their own, and existing in their own environment, you know. So C is for carry. This is the second version of this piece, which I love this one. I don't know.
It was a beautiful piece.
Thank you. So the eyes and friendship, this is one that I do think is successful on a background. I would love to remake this one and bump up the scale and really think about it. So this is actually the first one I made. So this is just literally mirroring the eye on the computer. When I did that, these extenders off the letter here, those are called serifs. So the serifs look like they were holding hands, and I was like, this is amazing. So just something as simple as that, and then sculpting the dots into faces, something like that. It's just, you know, finding these little relationships that letters can have with or without serifs, it's something that fascinates me. And then you really bring it to the next level when you think about scale and bumping these things up, you know, big. They become their own entities, and I think they start to lose their identity as letters when you go bigger with them, which is kind of fun too to think about. But I was thinking about friends, you know, just being online and whatever, during this, when I was making this one. U is for union. So this is an actual steel union joint. This one was really symbolic, I think, for my meeting my brother. My brother and I think, like, we have a lot of similarities. We both work with our hands. He's a firefighter for the city, but he's an amazing craftsman. Like, he builds stuff by hand, and it's just incredible the things that he's able to do. So it's weird, like, finding that other part of your existence, you know, and sharing the same kind of skills. So that union is one where I actually used a different typeface. This is one without serifs, so without the little extenders on the bottom. I think it was just a cleaner decision. Again, bouncing back and forth between fonts is something that I'm gonna start doing more of. But for this one, it was really nice. I think it's really clean. Like, it's just the way that it's just brought together by this one big joint was really important, you know, that I use that piece. And it's, you know, we both work with our hands, so the this thing in it itself is kind of symbolic, is something that, you know, we've both used in our own lives for whatever it is we're building. A is for abode. My son actually picked the color on this. So if you don't have a direct light on this piece, it looks black. And that's intentional because we looked for a house for like 2 years. It was insanity trying to find a place to live during COVID and all that. But part of the reason why we moved was because I wanted a bigger house for us so I could build like a shop and then have a studio area where I can put everything together. So I could be closer to my kids. Cause right now, we live 40 minutes from my job. So leaving and going to work is not always the best option, you know? So being closer to home was a huge factor in, the way I work. I needed to have a space to do all this stuff and continue to be a dad. So A is for abode. Like I said, it's pretty dark when you look at it, if it's not directly hit with light, but I wanted light to reveal the beauty of the glass itself. So I think that's really symbolic just for finding the right house and making it your own as a family, as you kind of grow into it, you know? So this is actually made of steel, the chimney, and then the inside here is also steel. I like beating up the surface of glass. I like leaving things rough and kind of unfinished because it's just a reflection of who I am and just the hardships that go into this material as a career and as, you know, as a lifestyle. It's tough, and it's, you know, I think that that's intentional, you know, for a good reason. Why is for yearning? Another one that was kind of symbolic for hearing my biological mother talk about the interaction with the man that who was my father. Kind of like a forbidden love, I guess, is the background of this one. But again, this is really big. It's probably the largest thing I've cast in my career so far. I mean, in terms of like one piece, it's really dense and heavy, but I made these molds out of insulation foam, and then I sculpted on top of them clay lips. So yeah, this one's pretty big, different. So during COVID, obviously we had a lot of crazy stuff going on in Chicago. My sister is a cop in the city, and she's a person of color. So she has a lot of interesting stories, you know, during that time when the rioting was happening, people were breaking into everywhere. And, you know, a lot of this was happening because of George Floyd's death, because of a person of color being murdered. But, you know, she was receiving the same amount of abuse as a person of color. So it was kind of the meaning behind a lot of this got kind of lost. And, you know, just hearing stories from her, just working in a normal weekend, like a holiday weekend, right? The amount of things that she would have to respond to, it's crazy. It's not a good job to be part of during that period of time. So that piece, this was actually from the 4th of July, the weekend of the 4th of July. I think this was like Friday to Saturday, the amount of people that were shot in Chicago. So the gun case, it's actually a G. Not everyone sees that at first, but it's a G. And this is a Glock 19, which is a pretty common handgun in the city of Chicago. One of the more used weapons on the streets. And these are actual 9mm casings. So this piece is pretty, pretty tightly related to Chicago and the gun violence associated in the city. It's just getting worse too. A lot of the incidences a long time ago were isolated to just the South Side, but now things are kind of pouring over into nicer areas of the city, and it's drawing a lot of fear. So it's it's sad. I love going to the city. I love, you know, it's a huge music town. So we got, you know, a lot of venues that I frequently visit for shows. So it is scary. You know, you got to be on your toes, and you got to be smart. But I love this piece, this one. So Sandy Hook was obviously the massacre that took place in Connecticut that happened with an AR-15. So recently the families, I think there was 9 families from the Sandy Hook incident that sued Remington and won. And this was the first time in American history that a gun manufacturer was held liable for the devastation it created. So this is a picture of the AR that was used in Sandy Hook. So this next piece I made is called Emotional Allegiance. So my idea behind Emotional Allegiance was that whenever a mass shooting happens, we always go online and we see the typical, you know, thoughts and prayers, whatever, while sending you thoughts and prayers. I wanted to make a piece not about a hatred for guns or, you know, gun control. This is about liability. And this is the first time where our words were words actually meant, they were weaponized to become something against a gun company. So Emotional Allegiance is kind of flipping the table and turning our words into action and creating change through that. So this is actually like a life size. I mean, it's 36 inches long. Yeah. And then the magazines are actually removable, so you can kind of switch them out, and interchange them like a real gun. This piece is made in 3 parts. So this was cast, the T was cast, the receiver was cast, and then this was cast. Oh, I'm sorry. 4 parts. And then I assemble it all by hand. This piece is pretty intense, I think. It's weird to hold it. And I brought this into a class at New Trier that they were talking about gun violence, and they wanted me to show some of these pieces. So I actually had kids like pass it around and hold it and interact with it. And you can see the unease, you know, even by the teachers, passing something like this around, even though the idea behind it isn't about pro guns. It's about, you know, making change with what we're saying and the words that we use to do it. So it is an interesting piece to hold. If you haven't been around guns, I think this is something that can make you pretty uncomfortable. And the fact that you can swap out the magazine like a real one, it's different.
Why did you use a T and a P with this piece?
For thoughts and prayers. Thoughts so and prayers, it's like it. yeah so that was kind of like the driving thing. So I actually I had a hard time finishing this one, and I wasn't going to, and then I was actually at work on the 4th of July in the morning, and I stopped in Highland Park to get a coffee on the way home, and then 3 hours later that man opened fired and killed a bunch of people. So that kind of accelerated me to finish it. And you know, I think that at least for where I work, it's kind of a constant reminder in the back of my head. Like, I work at a school, and there's a million people that are at this school. You know, what would be my way of handling a situation like that? If it were to happen where I work, I mean, I think a lot of people in that area think that they're untouchable. And I don't think that that's, I think it's just because it's an affluent community, you know, that there's that mindset that this can't happen here. There's no way this can happen here. But then it did. And that changes a lot. I think people are more aware of their surroundings now. But it's amazing the amount of support that surrounding communities have provided for Highland Park. But it's a very real thing that I kind of face on a daily basis working in a school. You know, we've had mishaps and accidents you know, people setting off the wrong alarm, trying to leave the building, stuff like that. But it is, it does give you some kind of sense of, you know, uneasiness throughout the day if you do think about it. So yeah, this piece, I think it was something different, a different approach to talking about guns, you know.
Yeah, it's a very, very powerful message, you know. It's a double take piece.
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
To think about it more than just once.
Yeah. So yeah, and then I just have a couple photos about, so this is my garage. We have a 3-car garage now. So I've built this wall in the summertime to separate the third space. It's just like a perfect little size shop for one person. I'll have a casting kiln and then my torch and stuff. Still waiting on ventilation. I got to figure all that out. But yeah, so like for the winter time, because I'm not going to have the garage open right now. It's like 15 degrees out.
Kerosene heater.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll figure that out. But so yeah, this has been taking up a lot of my time. Well, when the weather was nicer, I was in there working a lot, getting stuff built and fixed up. This is where I'm currently sitting right now. So this is like after the stuff's made, I just bring it home and I get to kind of chill and listen to music and just kind of work through my ideas. It's a nice space. Yeah. So I also have a little photo set up so I can shoot like smaller works, with ease. Bigger stuff, I can go to my school. We have a big photo studio there. More of a pain because they got to lug things back and forth, but it's nice having just like a little setup for shooting stuff. So yeah, thinking about the future, I still want to do some more gun control pieces. I'm starting to take letters apart and use the serifs, you know, to recreate things. This one is another, like a handgun, another Glock 19. Trying to figure out, but this one, I'm thinking of the word recoil a lot, the repercussions of what happens after like a something like a mass shooting, not even a school shooting, just a mass shooting, the repercussions on the community, on, you know, the places that you live, much like the blowback of a gun after it's discharged. So thinking about recoil, what does that mean? Where can I take that? And I'm also starting to play around with principles of design. So this actually spells out contour bias, which is like the way that our brain, the amygdala, processes danger. So like if you look at objects that are sharp versus round, we tend to favor things that are round and soft and edges rather than sharp. I'm not done with this one. This is like the beginning stage of it, but you know, thinking about our own biases and how we unconsciously think about things. And that's kind of what I'm starting to think about a little more. I've done a lot of workshops with bias through work and stuff. So I'm just pulling from all aspects of my life, you know, whether it's like personal stuff or even, like I said, like work. All those workshops are beneficial in some degree. So yeah, that's kind of what I have going on. I can actually show you guys. I got.
Why don't you stop sharing your screen real quick, or I'll kick you out real quick. There you go. Now I can pin you.
Yeah. So I got some other pieces here. This is actually a snake that I'm currently making. So again, playing around with the serifs. I've stacked multiple to suggest that it's like the rattler, and then this is the snake head. I'm actually going to recast this in the same color. This was just a clear cast, and then a metal tone. Mm-hmm. So playing around, this piece is actually a collaboration with a ceramicist from Pittsburgh who goes by the name of Zana Martin. She's making a little boy that's going to sit inside of this, and you'll have to wait for the meaning behind all of it because we're going to make a few. But yeah, so that this, you know, again, pushing scale. I also put this back in the kiln. I'm starting to like pick these things back up and like bend them to create more dramatic effects with the way that, you know, I'm hoping to create like more movement and stuff with them. Here's an example of a hand that I sculpted recently that will eventually hold this heart.
Thinking about kin, next of kin, next in your bloodline. So the letter K too. This piece will, I don't know how I'm going to mount all of it yet, but it's all going to be kind of one with the hand and the heart and the K. This is another variation. So normally if I'm working, I try to like make multiples in different ways to see what is more successful. So this is just like kind of like a sketch, basically, playing around with copper wire and stuff like that. So, but yeah.
Very cool. Well, thank you, Mike, for giving us a glimpse into your world today. We really appreciate it. It's very powerful stuff you're working on. I'm glad you had a chance to refocus during the pandemic, you know, and really like try something new. And it's interesting you have that opportunity because not many people do. They work every single day and don't have that pause in life to reapproach and do something that you really feel like is the next step. It's also interesting to hear you talk about work where you have to move on mentally to the next body of work because it's technically not healthy. You know, you get obsessed and then you realize that something has to be done. Awesome, man. Well, thank you again for joining us today and being part of our NGG family. The works that he's shown at the end are available for sale. I have a price list should anybody want to see and get an idea of what Mike's work costs. And a lot of his work is obviously with him in his studio. And I'm looking forward to seeing what you do next. Keep us all posted.
Great.
It really is a powerful experience to, you know, to get your perspective too, as like we are, like I have two kids, almost three kids in school, to really understand like the pressures and the theories and the scares that exist. Like you said, no one's truly ever safe, and it's that's true in everything.
Yep, for sure.
It's great to have you talk to us today. But thank you all for joining me this weekend. Went a little long, but it was definitely worth it. And we'll see you all next week. If you're watching this on YouTube, like, subscribe, hit this bell and share. We're going to put this up on YouTube later today and post it out to those who can't join us. Join us every Saturday. Next Saturday, we're going to be going over the Masterworks auction piece by piece. I hope to have the Habitat's founder, Ferdinand, join me. And Corey will hopefully be there too to talk about the pieces. So again, great to have you all and have a great weekend.
Thank you, guys. Thank you, everyone.
All right. Thanks, guys. Be well. Bye-bye.